Hi everyone, I'm asked to review this Australian-made new violin, a kangaroo violin. And I decided to make this video a bit educational. So I'll be sharing what to look for when buying a violin and especially how to choose between going for an antique instrument, an old violin, or a new violin by a maker who is still alive. So I'll be comparing this violin built by Paul Ridden to my own old German violin. I'm just going to pretend like we are in the shop together and you are buying your next level violin, let's say in a price range of $2,000 to $10,000, something like that. So next level, not a beginner or student violin. And I will be your teacher and I will give you some tips what to look for and also how to find your instrument, because I get a lot of questions like, oh, Zlata, what violin should I buy? What bow should I buy? Well, you shouldn't do anything. It's very personal. So what I always do is that I encourage my students to really decide for themselves and to learn to listen and really find something after their own taste. Now, what you have been waiting for probably when you are watching this video is how do these violins sound? So I'm going to play on both of them and I'm going to tell you a little bit more about how the violin market works and how it works with pricing and if an old violin is more expensive or perhaps cheaper than a new violin. So sorry for rambling. Let's hear the violin side by side and please let me know in the comments what you think. So it can be very different from someone else who comments. It's your taste, but I would really like to know what you hear in these violins. Also, later in this video, I tell you if I would buy this violin for myself. In the demonstration, you might hear some weird sounds. I can guarantee you that both of the violins don't have some kind of weird side noise. But I'm here with baby Tristan. And, well, he is awake during the day and he's making all kinds of sounds. And he also gets very enthusiastic if I play violin, so he starts sort of singing along. So I tried to pick fragments where he didn't do that. Funny story, they say that high fats as a baby... when his father played the violin, he started crying at out-of-tune notes and started laughing when it was good. Well, Tristan is mainly happy when I play, but maybe he's just laughing like, haha, mom, you missed that note, ha ha ha. So we'll never know. Now, when I was buying my own violin, I wasn't really looking for a new violin or an old violin. I was just looking for a violin that would fit my needs and... which I would enjoy playing and also would open possibilities for me. By the way, in other reviews and comparison videos, I got some comments about that I play a little bit different on the different violins. Well, there are two things. First is that I have spent a couple of days playing on the Australian violin to get to know it and to see how it sounds best. So the way you play one violin is different from the way you play another violin. The same goes for bows. So you need to get to know an instrument and learn how you can play together. The second thing is that I'm not a robot and I'm definitely not Ling Ling. So yeah, there is some inconsistency in my playing, of course. And even on the same violin, I don't play the same thing exactly the same. Well, you know, it's music is an art after all. So when a student asks me advice about buying a violin, I first look if the violin is technically okay, if I like the shape of the fingerboard and the bridge. And I've got an interview right here with the maker of this violin in which he explains how the setup matters when you buy a violin and also how it's personal. Now, this particular instrument, it feels, it's not really heavy, but it feels like it doesn't feel big, viola. No, it's not that way. But it feels like you have something in your hands. Like some French violins are very slim in the neck. It feels, yeah, it's relatively thick. It can be difference of like a millimeter or something. And you know, choosing a violin is not only choosing the sound, but it's also choosing how it feels and how you play on it. So I don't have a very small violin. I have a German violin. When I switch from this violin to my own violin, I notice that it feels smaller and lighter. It's not heavy to make sound on this violin because it speaks very easily. So that's also something you want to look for. Do you easily get a full sound out of the violin, or do you really have to use a lot of weight or pressure to get the violin to sound? And is the note there right away, or do you get some kind of in-between sound because before it really starts to sound? Well, in this case, this violin is... yeah, it responds in a very easy way. So you don't have to do much effort to play it. In terms of the character, and please let me know in the comments how you experienced that. How I experienced it is that I think with my violin I can more easily make nuances in the sound, like dynamic changes. Here the sound is very easily there, but then it takes perhaps more effort to dose it. It sounds very vague, I know it. And these are the things that you find out when you play on several instruments. If you are thinking, like, Zata, what are you talking about? Then just go try 10 different violins. And that's very important if you are buying a violin, to try out a lot of instruments, because then you can see what you like and what you don't like, because that's really important. Because this can be like a perfect violin for someone. And Paul sells his violins for like from $5,000, US dollars, I believe, and it depends a little bit on the options, etc. So you have to discuss that with him. I'm not going to be in between that. In terms of pricing, old violins can go anywhere. So I bought my violin for 2,000 euros, but that is that was really a steal. That was like half buying, half being sponsored. So if you want to buy something similar as I have, you quickly go, in the direction of 5,000, maybe over $10,000 dollars or euros. It really depends, because certainly old violins, you don't have to pay someone to make a living out of it. So they can be highly priced if they sound good, and certainly if they are from a well-known maker from the past. But they can also be priced relatively low. So to answer the question, is it cheaper to buy an old or new violin? It really depends. It really depends. I think also with new violins, typically, if you buy a violin that is from a self-taught maker, and they can be great, like this is also a good violin, they are typically around, let's say, the $5,000 or $7,000, which is this violin. So I would say that this one is like reasonably priced. It's not too expensive. In cheaper countries like Romania or Czech, then you could buy like a violin made from beginning to end by one maker, so not a workshop violin, for around 3,000. If you go for makers who are trained in, let's say, the big violin schools like Newark in England, Mittenwald in Germany, like Cremona in Italy, of course, you know, the most well-known, or in France, Mircourt. I don't know if that school is still there. Usually those instruments go for, let's say, the 10,000, 20,000, 30,000 price range. If you buy from a maker who's trained there, and lots of those makers also have their own violin shops. And if you go for a violin maker who won a couple of prizes, an international prizes, then the price is also higher. So that's kind of the range of prices that you're looking at for like a next level violin. So, and of course the bone makes a difference. So here is the Paul Ridden violin with a different bow. It needs to match, like, you and the violin and the bow, a bow that you like very much. I maybe hate, and the other way around. So that's also very personal. I do recommend first going for the violin and then finding a bow that goes along with it. Now, and then some people see the violin as an investment. Well, first of all, I want you to have the priority. Are you buying a violin for you? Or are you buying a violin as an investment? Because those are two different things. Because as an investment, you might go to an auction and buy a violin by a well-known maker that you buy cheap, and then you can sell it expensive or whatever you want. A violin that you buy for yourself can be a violin that you find beautiful, but that perhaps doesn't do much on the market. So, you know, those are two different things. So don't go and try to find a violin for yourself with the thought of that you're also buying it as an investment. Of course, the two can, you know, it can be combined, but you must be lucky to find something that is a good violin for you and also a good investment. So if that's the path that you're looking at, that's that. Now, maybe you were waiting to hear if I would buy this violin for myself. Well, no, because I'm sending it back. And that is just because I feel on emotional level that the old violin that I have suits me better. I don't want to part with it. And I'm simply not in the position to buy a second violin at the moment. So that's why I'm not doing it. I'm very attached to my current instrument. Very happy with it. If I play on something else, I am happy to return to it. So I'll just stay with my own violin. It's not for sale. But I would recommend buying a violin by Paul if you like it, of course. So it really depends if you like the feel of the instrument and if you really like the sound, if it fits your needs. And so good luck on your journey of picking a violin. It can be really hard, I know. But it's also a very interesting journey. So I wish you all the best with that. And please comment below what your findings are from this video. Thanks so much for watching. Consider subscribing for free violin lessons. And see you next time. Bye.